I want everybody to smile. Some of you haven't smiled this week. You say, I have nothing to smile about, and I will tell you, if you're a child of God, you have everything to smile about. If you're here today and you've never trusted Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, you truly have everything to smile about because there's still hope for you, because you still have breath within you. And like I say all the time, as long as there's breath, there is hope. Let's not give up, okay? We've been talking about grace. Grace, the unmerited favor of God poured out on us by our faith in Christ. It's a compelling change agent that, when received, it teaches us how to live. If I will truly experience the grace of God, it will change me and it will teach me how to live this thing called life. I'm afraid too many people are not experiencing the true, powerful, incredible, life-changing, eternity-changing grace of God. We call ourselves Christians. We say we're saved. We say we're born again. I've got three words for you. Live like it. Live like it. Are you a Christian? Then act like it. Have you been born again by the precious blood of Jesus Christ that was shed on the cross? Then your life should reflect that. You know I don't like drama, right? Those of you who know me very well, you know I don't like drama. You know, your life can be drama-free. You say, well, wait a minute, you don't know those other people in my family. It's not about the other people in your family, it's about you. But wait a minute, you don't know that crew that I work with. It's not about them, it's about you. My drama-free life is not based upon everybody else, it's based upon how I handle it. And when I let the Holy Spirit of God handle it for me, then it's drama-free. I want our church to be drama-free. We're slipping a little bit. I'm hearing too much drama. It's time to stop it. We're not going to be a church of drama, okay? And if you think I'm talking to you, I don't even know who you are as far as the drama goes. I just know what I've been sensing and what I've been feeling and what I've been hearing about some things. Stop it. Stop it. We're not going to be a church of drama. It's just that simple, right? Okay. Dramas are for soap operas. And ladies, you need to stop watching them. There's nothing godly about them. Grace, as wonderful as it is, and it is, it's amazing. It's not a free pass that allows us to throw off all restraint. We talked about that last week, what grace is not. It's not a license to sin. It's not. And so if I say I'm a Christian, then you know what I need to do? I need to live like it. And I want to encourage us. Tim Keller says, and we'll get to the whole quote here in a minute, so don't go to it yet. Tim Keller says, the gospel devours the very motivation you have for sin. Now, I want you to think about that. I'll put it up on the screen here in just a moment, and you'll see it better, and you can just really chew on it for a moment. But the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, devours, or it should devour, the very motivation that we have for sin. Our motivation should be to never sin. Shouldn't it? Shouldn't it? And so when we think about the gospel, Jesus came, he died for the sins of the world. And so since he did that, we should say, Jesus, since you did something so wonderful for me, my desire should be to never go against that. And when we sin, we do. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Are you a Christian? Are you a child of God? Have you been born again? Have you been gloriously saved? Has there been a time when you truly trusted Jesus as your Lord and Savior? Then 2 Corinthians 5:17 says this, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, that's a believer. He is a new creation, brand new. How many of you remember the day? I remember it like it was yesterday. The old has passed away, and behold, new has come. Life changed, or should have, the moment you trusted Jesus as Savior. If it didn't, if there was nothing that changed about you, if you didn't feel, never felt the presence of the Holy Spirit move within you, if your life and your desires didn't change at least a little bit, then maybe you didn't get it. Just saying. Verse 18, all this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself. Reconciled means to restore friendly relations. And God restored friendly relations between man and himself by sending Jesus to die on the cross. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself. He opened the door back for friendly relations. Aren't you thankful? Huh? Are you thankful? Amen. But catch this. And he gave us the ministry of reconciliation. A couple of weeks ago, we talked about what grace is. Last week, we talked about what grace is not. Today, we're going to talk about how we need to learn how to give grace to others. It'll change your life. Some of you won't be so mean. Some of you won't be so snarky. Is that a word? That's a word, isn't it? Snarky? It's not a cuss word, is it? Not yet. It will be someday. It's probably on the don't say list right now in Congress or whatever. But God has called us through his son Jesus. He's called us to the ministry of reconciliation. What does that mean to you? To me, it means that we are to be restoring friendly relations. How many of you have somebody that you know can't stand you? Raise your hand. I want to see some hands. You know, you have, come on, don't be ashamed. They can't stand you. And maybe you've given them a reason not to be able to stand you. Maybe you've not. Whatever. Did I say that all right? Maybe you've given them a reason not to be able to stand you. Whatever. You know what I'm saying. Play along with me. And maybe you haven't. Maybe you don't know what you've done for those people to just despise you the way they do or hold unforgiveness against you. I don't know. But God's word tells me that we have been given the ministry of reconciliation. Now, yes, you can only do what you can do because you've got somebody else involved. You can't force somebody to like you. You can't force somebody to forgive you. You can't force somebody to even want to look at you or say your name. But you can still do your part in loving. You can still do your part in praying for. You can still do your part in blessing. You can still do your part in forgiving, because that's what you've been given, the ministry of reconciliation. And what we do, if we're not careful, we allow these people to control our lives, to control our moods, to control our being. And that's not the way it ought to be. Back to the quote from Tim Keller. He says, "The gospel devours the very motivation you have for sin. It completely saps your very need and reason to live any way you want." As a child of God, we don't have the right to live any way we want. Do we? Do you believe that? Anyone who insists the gospel encourages us to sin has simply not understood it yet, nor begun to feel its power. Turn to 1 Peter chapter 1. I got quite a few verses today, and I want to make sure we get through to them, because that's the most important thing I'm going to say to you today, what God's word says. 1 Peter chapter 1, starting in verse 14. It says, "As obedient children..." As what kind of children? Obedient. What's an obedient child? Doing what you're told, when you're told, with the right heart attitude. That is the best definition of obedience you'll ever hear. It's not mine. I wish I could take credit, but it's not. "But as obedient children, do not be conformed to the passions of your former ignorance." Remember when you used to be ignorant about the things of God? Seriously. You were just ignorant. Unlearned is what that means. There are people who are genuinely saved right now, but they're still ignorant about the things of God because we're not allowing ourselves to be taught the precepts of God, his word. That's why I encourage you all the time as individuals to be reading God's word. Friday, I was having a bad couple of days. I really was. I was feeling something inside of me that I didn't like, and I couldn't pinpoint it. It felt like a little bit of oppression going on. And I, to this day, I don't know exactly what it was, but I know it wasn't from God, right? God does not oppress us. God's not the author of confusion. He doesn't bring confusion into us. And so I got out, and I got the mower out, and I thought, well, I'll just listen to a little bit of music. And I put the music on, and I said, stop it. Stop right now. Shut the mower off. I put the Word of God on. I'm not saying this sounds super spiritual, because I'm not super spiritual. I put the Word of God on, and I plugged it into my ears, and I started with the book of Philippians. and I just started mowing, listening to the Word of God come into my ears. Just listening, not paying a whole lot of attention where I was going. Push more, you can't get too far out of it. She won't let me have a riding mower. But I'm just going, and I'm hearing the Word of God, and instead of just listening to it, I'm listening to it. I'm absorbing it. And you know, when I got done mowing, all sweaty and nasty like I always am, I shut it off and I sat on the front porch, and it was a nice cool breeze, shady, got me some water, and I sat there and I just talked to God. And you know, all that feeling left. It just left. It disappeared. And you say, but you're a pastor. You're not supposed to feel those things. Take care of a bunch of sheep for long enough and you'll start feeling things too. But what I'm saying about that is I could have continued going down that road and no telling where it would have led. But what happened is I put the Word of God. I didn't go turn on some preacher to listen to him preach. I turned the music off because sometimes the music gets in the way. And we think just because we're listening to good, wholesome K-Love that everything's okay. I want to encourage you on your Bible app. It will read to you. Turn it on and just let it come into your brain. And some of these days when you're feeling depression, when you're feeling down, when you're feeling mad, when you're feeling beat up, when you're feeling like you want to beat somebody up, you just put the Word of God into your ears. And I'm telling you, it changes you. Don't be conformed to the passions of your former ignorance, but as He who called you is holy, you also be holy in how much of your conduct? All your conduct. You're not being holy when you're telling somebody what you think about them in a bad way. You're not being holy when, I know I went through all this last week, but when you're doing some things, you're just not being holy. And God's Word says, but as He who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. And I think as a child of God, understanding that the grace of God that was so freely for me given, but it cost the Father and it cost the Son tremendously, if I think about His grace, then I should desire to live a life of holiness. And when I'm living a life of holiness, then I'm not only trying to please God, but I'm also showing grace to other people. See what I'm saying? Verse 16, since it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. I don't think that's a suggestion. I think God is commanding us to live a separate, set apart, that's what holy means, lifestyle. That's what He wants from His children. Now, here's what we have to think. Did what Jesus did on the cross, does it matter enough to us that we look at it and say, you know, because of your love and your grace to me, I'm going to love you with everything that I've got and I'm going to show grace to others. Shouldn't that be our attitude? Shouldn't it? It should. A pursuit of holiness isn't done in a relational vacuum. You know, a lot of people are just, they're just in their own vacuum. And I get that. I want to be alone sometime. I don't always want to be around people. But a pursuit of holiness, I think, needs to be, yes, it's an individual thing, but I think it works better when we do it with all of us. You know what I'm saying? It's something believers should be doing together. We should together be seeking holiness. We together should be seeking showing grace to one another and showing grace to others. And I'll tell you this, it's observed by the lost people around us when we do. When we're showing grace, lost people around us observe that. They see it. When we're showing love for God, lost people see that. Here's a point. Grace for others is always a priority. We should be